So, welcome everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here and to welcome you to the Skin and the Hair Symposium. So, I am going to discuss with you about the latest update in acne pathophysiology. Here you have my conflict of interest. Where we are today, so concerning the three main actors of acne, that is the bacillus, so bacteria and microbiome, and finally keratinocyte of the follicle. Concerning so these three factors, the first one is the sebaceous gland, which is really of great interest is that it has been identified that you have stem cell here at the junctional zone, and they are able to differentiate either in sebaceous or in keratinocyte, depending of the Wnt signal. If you have a high activation of Wnt signal, you are induced a differentiation in keratinocyte. If you have low activation, it will induce the stem cell in a differentiation to sebaceous. So, what we know today is that the control of the Wnt signal is under R receptor, which is a negative control. So it inhibits Wnt signal. In the comedon, we know that we have a strong activation of Wnt signal, abnormal proliferation of keratinocyte and differentiation with an atrophy of sebaceous gland. And now we have identified some factor which are able to activate so this RHR receptor. It means that is of particular interest for treatment. And here you have the example of all acne. So all acne as chlor acne is induced by the activation of this transcriptor factor. So, concerning the sebaceous gland, other important information, as you can see here on this figure, we have more and more receptors which have recently been identified, showing that they are able to activate the production of sebum. So, among these receptors, I am going to discuss hyaluronic acid and adenocannabinoid. So, the first one is a randomized double-blind study versus placebo in a split facial trial. So with 20 women, they were able to demonstrate that after 30 minutes of local anesthesia, one side received hyaluronic acid, and you can see that you have a significant decrease of the sebum production compared to the control side with saline water. And so you have therapeutic research in this field. Concerning the endocannabinoid system, you can see here that when you incubate, so the lipids, the gouttelet of lipid and sebaceous, so with the endocannabinoid, you are able just here with linoleic acid and testosterone to induce a high suppression of lipid droplets. You can see it's low with cannabidiol. And if you pre-incubate your sebaceous with this cannabidiol, you can see that you inhibit so the production of lipid droplets by linoleic acid and testosterone. You have exactly the same thing if you use cutaneous biopsy. So, what does it mean? It means that cannabidiol is able to inhibit lipogenic action of both linoleic acid and testosterone. So the interest is both against comedon and inflammatory lesions. So here is very important new information concerning the development of atrophic skin. Indeed, as you can see here, when you have a skin without any evolution to scars, you can see that after 3 weeks of treatment, so you have a disappearance of the macrophage, T lymphocyte, and B lymphocyte. On the contrary, you can see here that when you have the development of atrophic scar, so you always have a very important infiltrate associated with the disappearance of sebaceous gland. What does it mean? It means that if you block the inflammation very early, you could be able to avoid the appearance of scars. And it means that the scars in the scar, the sebaceous gland and the atrophy of sebaceous gland plays a crucial role, as you can see here. So now if we move to the cutaneous bacterium acne, first thing, now we speak about cutibacterium acne is a new classification of the propionibacterium acne on the skin. So here you can see that if you compare acne patient and normal individual concerning the quantity of cutibacterium acne, it's very similar. Here, it's exactly the same thing. It's very similar, and you have a good diversity in patients with acne. So the consequence is that acne is not related to the proliferation of cutibacterium acne. Very important. We don't have to kill cutibacterium acne. But as you can see here, we demonstrated that, in fact, you have a loss of diversity of the phenotype. You have six phenotypes, and in acne, the phenotype 1A1 is significantly higher both on the face and on the back. And here we demonstrated in vitro, in my laboratory, that when you incubate so skin explant with only one extract, one phenotype, as here, 2 and 3. You induce the expression of interleukin 17. And you can see that it's very high with 1A1. But if you combine, so the 3 phenotype, that means that you simulate the diversity, you decrease significantly the secretion of interleukin 17. What does it mean? It means that is a loss of diversity is in charge, is responsible of the inflammation, and if you are able to induce again the diversity of the phenotype, you can decrease the inflammation. So what has been shown is that when the T lymphocytes are in contact with sebaceous gland, so sebaceous gland is able to differentiate this CD4 T lymphocyte in Th17 lymphocyte, which are able to secrete interleukin 17. So sebaceous recruit T cell in the skin and differentiate them in Th17 cell. And what, as you can see here, again, in a similar manner than with interleukin 1, in acne lesion, you have an increase of interleukin 17, specifically induced by the T lymphocytes and monocytes on Th17 cells. So cutibacterium acne is able to activate this interleukin 17 production. So we have the confirmation that cutibacterium acne is definitively involved in the formation of the microcomedan. So it plays a role very early in the development of acne lesion. Treatment, as I mentioned to you previously, it's very important to control the loss of diversity of the phenotype. So what we have in the future for the treatment? First, vaccination. And concerning vaccination, one important factor secreted by cutibacterium acne play a crucial role in inflammation. It's CAM factor. And we have, so the first study which has been performed using CAM factor in a vaccine, and this cytotoxic factor is of particular interest. And all we are only doing is a phase 1 of vaccinations. So, other approach in the future is that you take a swab. With a swab, you take the microbiote or the microbiome of your patient. So, by example, on the face for acne patient, you identify the microorganism of interest as Cutibacterium acnes and Staphylococcus epidermidis. You can make culture, in vitro culture, and finally, so you can, it's optional research that you can perform at the same time, but for the patient, you can create its own probiotic or prebiotic capsules or cream. And so changing our microbiome is very important. We know that we have dysbiosis, and as you can see here, prebiotic and probiotic, you have the first trial which has been performed to try to act to regulate the microbiome and having mainly an action on inflammatory lesion. So the future of acne treatment, vaccination, bacteriophage, which has been identified in the pilosebaceous unit, and finally, what we name bacteriotherapy, that means probiotic, prebiotic, and antimicrobial peptide, which are named postbiotic. So thank you very much for your attention.